How much did the company invest in equipment? Read the paper. How much? Read those 7,000. So we have minus 7,000. This is not minus minus. Just to let you know. So the way you would do it here is equal to. This is equal to negative 5,000 minus 7,000 minus dividends. How much was dividends? 25,000. So the full amount, the total amount is how much? Minus 25,000. This is equal to this is not it. So this is minus 37,000. This is your free cash flow. Guys, do you have any question about that? This is the, how you prepare the statement of cash flow. Basically, what you need to do is do them step by step. Okay? So you have... Guys, I can't hear him. Sorry? The amount is basically whatever the company invested in equipment. And basically property, plant, and equipment. So those are the amounts that the company invested in property, plant, and equipment. Okay? Now there's something that you might want to look at here. You see this 7,000 here? This is one of the things that the exam will be a little bit more complicated about this point here. You might not be given purchases. You might have to calculate the purchases. Okay? So let's say that they did not give you the 7,000. What do you have to do here? So what do you have to do here? You have to calculate purchases. How do you calculate purchases? For one, the first thing you have always the beginning balance. So how do you calculate how much the company purchased over a year? You look first at what? What the company originally had as equipment, right? And then during the year they purchased some equipment, they sold equipment, and they end up with ending balance, right? We have the ending balance, we have the beginning balance. We know how much the company sold. You will be told that the company sold such and such. You have to account for any gains or losses, because this will affect also the net balance, right? So let's see how. Beginning balance, PP&E, net. Do you remember what we mean by PP&E net? This is property, plant, and equipment minus accumulated depreciation, because this is the combined value. This will give you what? The book value, right? Do you remember that? Property, plant, and equipment less accumulated depreciation. So this is the beginning balance. During the year, what do you have? Plus purchases. Add purchases. Then what do you have? You subtract what? What do you subtract? What? What do you subtract? What are we talking about here? Property and equipment. You subtract depreciation. But before that, we have purchases and then what? So what do you have next?
Sales.
Less sales of equipment. And then you have, you need to subtract what? And then? Depreciation. Less depreciation. What else? You still have gains and losses. If you have gains, what do? Add gains, less losses. This will give you what? Ending balance. Okay? PPE net. Okay, so look at it this way. You started off with a certain amount. Here you were taking depreciation into consideration. So we have, basically you have the beginning balance, you add any equipment you purchase, you subtract equipment that you sold. Okay? Then you have to remove depreciation expense, because here what we're talking about is the net value. After that, we have to remove gains and losses. Now, let's say that here the company did not actually give us purchases. They didn't give us purchases of 7,000. How do you calculate? Purchases, so in this case, if you want to do it this way, you have, this is, ending balance is equal to beginning balance. I'm going to remove the word PP&E, net, etc., because it's the same thing. So beginning balance plus purchases minus sales minus depreciation plus gain minus loss. Are we good with that? I'm just writing it in an equation format. So purchases are equal to what? You have, just move everything to the other side. You have ending balance minus beginning balance plus sales plus depreciation minus gain plus loss. So let's plug in the numbers. It's equal to, so we have equal to, ending balance is how much? What's ending balance? Net. Look at it, net. So ending balance is equal to 17,000 minus 27. Right? This is ending balance. Guys, ending balance is equipment less accumulated depreciation for that year. Because we'll talk about it as net. Minus, the second one is beginning balance, is how much? 78,000 minus? Come on. 24,000. And then what do we have? Sales. They told us that they sold it for 12,000 minus 12. Okay? Then minus depreciation, which is 6,000. Do you have gains or losses? Minus 0 plus 0. So this is what it will be. So the amount that it will be. Okay? Give me 1 second. So let's copy this one here. Okay. Now, where is the mistake? Sorry? We're supposed to add depreciation. Okay? So here, this one, supposed to be added. And the 12,000 are supposed to be added, right? Okay. So in this case here, purchases is equal to depreciation. Thank you, Bobby. This is the 7,000 that we have. Now, accumulated depreciation, if you look at it here, the changes that we had. Accumulated depreciation, there was an increase in 3,000. However, depreciation expense was 6,000, right? Remember, you have 3,000 here, and we have another 3,000 here from the ones that were basically this one you are selling equipment. Do you understand now those 6,000 where they went? Yes. Because we're talking here about the net value. So actually you can do it without looking at the net value, without looking at the ones minus depreciation expense. It might confuse you, and then you might, because if you're not giving depreciation expense, you will have to figure it out yourself. The easiest way, this is based on what I understood from students, is when you have it like this. You have the net value, that's easy. You have every year, it will be the same thing, 70,000 minus 25. So it will be this one minus this one. Or this one, and then you have the beginning balance will be this one minus this one. Then you simply subtract depreciation. You could have done it without including depreciation and without looking at the net PP&E, but it can get more confusing. That's much easier to do it. It gets a little bit more complicated once you have to factor in accumulated depreciation if you don't look at it this way. Yes? This one?
Yeah, but can you put the numbers like...
I will send this one to Blackboard. I think I actually did already. And I think it also has those ones. If it's not, I'm going to add it again. Do you have any questions? Okay. Now there's one last thing that I need to cover in like 5-10 minutes. This is the statement of cash flow. The thing that will be changing is that simply, as you can see here, those additional information that we need, or the adjustments that we need to make here, they're not comprehensive. The one that you will be doing in later on will be more comprehensive. You will have gains and losses, etc. That's what's different. You will have common stock, etc. Do you understand this? Okay. Now, the last thing that I want to talk about is this one. I can't hear you. I swear I can't. Basically, I can hear you. This is what is making me confused. Guys, so you have here, we have here a statement of cash flows under the direct method. You see, under the direct method, we're doing the same thing that we did with the investing activities and financing activities. So you have investing activities and financing activities. We used to list cash inflows, cash outflows. We do the same thing for operating activity. This is why academics they like it, because it's conceptually more correct. The VASB would prefer it. However, companies, they find this one a little bit more complicated. So in this case, what you need to do is you look at, for the investing activities and financing activities, it's exactly prepared in the exact same way as the indirect method. So what you do here is you prepare cash inflows and cash outflows. When does a company receive cash? From customers, right? From sales or services. So you have cash receipts from customers, etc. You might also have some cash receipts from dividends and interest. This is when the company receives cash. Good? Remember, gains and losses are not included here. There is no payment that the company will receive where on the check is written as gain. They don't do that. Okay? So you have here cash receipts from customers or from dividends and interest. Cash payments can go to employees, rent, utilities, taxes, suppliers. All these will be cash outflows. So for the statement of cash flows under the direct method, you list all these ones one by one. Here we don't start with net income. You don't need to start from net income and start adjusting. adjusting that to get to that cash. You're actually listing them one by one. The information that is needed to prepare the statement of cash flows under the direct method is the same: comparative balance sheets, income statement, and additional information. And this is exactly the same one that we used for the other examples. The difference here is that for accounts receivable, okay, when you have an increase in accounts receivable, so what you need to do is you need to look at cash inflows that are from customers. Those are the payments that the customers made. However, in order to adjust for those revenues, in order to adjust for that amount, what you need to look at is what part of those sales revenues were actually in cash. Do you understand that? What part of those revenues were actually in cash? Those are the cash inflows. And what other cash the company collected? Do you remember when we had an increase or decrease in accounts receivable? This is the same way here. So what you have here, you have cash receipts from customers. This is sales revenue. But then you adjust for the revenues, you adjust them for the change in account receivable. If you have a decrease in account receivable, you add it. Why? That simply means that the company received all the revenues from this year in cash, plus they collected some of the previous accounts receivable from the previous year. So they actually received more cash than the revenues. As a result, you add the decrease in accounts receivable, you subtract the increase from basically an account receivable. Cash payments to suppliers. This is the amount of cash that the company purchased, that the company paid for the suppliers. Why would you pay for your suppliers? You pay your supplier because you purchased goods from them, right? So those are the cost of your inventory. So basically what you start with is, you start with the cost of those purchases. According to the accrual basis, the cost was the cost of goods sold. This is the amount that the company recognized as the cost of inventory, because they matched the inventory, basically the expense, with the revenue, with the amount sold during that year. Under the cash basis, you start with the cost of goods sold, and then you adjust for changes in inventory and your changes in your payable. First, you adjust for the changes in inventory. Why? Because if you purchase more than you actually sold, there will be an increase in inventory. That means you paid more than you actually recognized. So an increase in inventory will be added. This is different from what you have here, because here we're looking at cash outflow. This is cash outflows, cash payments. So cash outflows, that means the company made more payments. As a result, the company will add the increase in inventory. And if there's a decrease in inventory, that means the company used some of the products that they had in their warehouses. So they subtract that. Now, in addition to that, the company will have to adjust for the changes in accounts payable. They want to make sure that those purchases were in cash. Only the cash purchases will be accounted for. So if you have an increase in accounts payable, it means you paid less than you actually recognized. So a decrease in accounts payable means you paid less, right? No, wrong. An increase in accounts, see? I know that you're tired, but you have to still think. Yes, it's not. An increase in accounts payable means that you basically did not pay everything you purchased this year. So an increase in accounts payable will be subtracted. A decrease in accounts payable, it simply means that the company paid more. This is cash outflow. The company paid more. They paid whatever they purchased this year plus some of the outstanding accounts payable. Now you have other operating activities, other operating expenses. From operating expenses, you start with operating expenses, the overall thing. Okay, then you have to adjust for prepaid expenses, because prepaid expenses under the accrual basis, only the part think about it again as insurance policy. Only the insurance policy that has expired would be recognized under the cash basis. All the prepaid expenses would be recognized now. So if you have an increase in prepaid expenses, it simply means that the company, if you have an increase in prepaid expenses, it means the company purchased a new policy. As a result, the whole amount should be added. And if you have, you also need to adjust for accruals. So in this case, if you have accrued expenses, like accrued interest, under the accrual basis, the company will recognize that. So if you have a decrease in accrued expense, that means that the company paid that. If you have an increase in accrued expenses, it means that the company actually recognized it, but they didn't pay it, so you have to deduct it. Okay? Interest, revenue, and basically you have here cash payments for income tax. That's basically same thing. You look at the income tax expense, and then you adjust for income tax payable to see whether there was changes in the liability account income tax payable. Okay? This is how it would look like under the direct method. You have cash inflows, that basically cash received from suppliers, and you have cash outflows too. So cash inflows from, or cash received from customers, and then you have cash payments to suppliers, for interest, for taxes, for operating expenses, etc. This will give you net cash provided by operating activities. This is the same amount as the amount that is mentioned, that is the amount that was calculated under the indirect method. It has to be the same amount. Any questions? It was nice knowing you guys. See you all.